that we have service every Sunday, not just on Easter Sunday, okay? If you will please fill out your Connect cards. It has your information on the front. And if you're here every week, if you will just write, well, don't do this, but just write David Love up there. We'll know you're here, okay? Your name may be Johnny Smith, and you can write that on there. But just write your name on there and make sure that we know you're here. A lot of times somebody will say, oh, I hadn't seen so-and-so in a long time. And we don't know where they are. So if you keep in contact with us through these, then we'll know how you're doing, all right? And it is to, if we have, if someone in your family is in the hospital and we need to contact you about that, we're able to do that, okay? And then your prayer requests are listed, you can list those on the back. As we come to worship this morning, we light our candle. We light our candle to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world. Let's pray. Father, as we come to you this morning, we come with our burdens. We come to you with our dreads. And we ask to give those to you right now. We lay them down so that our hearts will be clear and our minds will be clear, and that we can focus on your word as we worship today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our first hymn is Blessed Assurance. Please stand and join us as we sing.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, burst at my side. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Is called Come to the Water, and I'll go ahead and tell you, it's okay to dance if you want to, but not you two. We come to that time in our service where we consecrate our tithes and our offerings. If you are a visitor, we want to, for our service, to bless you, and we want to tell you that you're under no obligation to give. We don't want you to feel any pressure to do that. If you would like to give today, there are boxes in the back. If you'd like to go online, you can give that way, or you can go to the church office and drop your offering off. So let's pray. Father, as we give these gifts back to you, since everything that we have is yours and comes from you, we return this small portion as you have asked us to do. And we pray, Father, that our church leadership will use this money to do your will in our community, that we will be a congregation that will financially support the ministries of our church, but that also we will support programs outside of our church walls for the betterment of our community. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing Standing on the Promises. If you will stand and join us, please. Verses of Have Thine Own Way, Lord.
Thou art
We just sang those words, search me and try me. Savior, today. Father, we pray that those words will be our prayer. That we will let you search us. That we will let the Holy Spirit come in and reveal those areas in our lives where we need to correct our actions. God our Father, who together with your Son Jesus Christ gave us the gift of the Holy Spirit, we come to you in worship today as we praise you for your goodness and we thank you for your mercies and your grace. We realize, Father, that as people who believe that you are the Creator and that Jesus is your Son and that he rose from the grave for the forgiveness of our sins, that we belong to you. We are no longer just some insignificant nobody, but we are your children. We are a child of God. We thank you for Jesus and for his death on Calvary and that his resurrection has purchased our salvation. We also know, Father, that if we believe what your Holy Scriptures say, then our lives should be different. And we pray for this change to take place, Father, that we, the people who belong to you, will reconnect with you and that we will recommit our lives to living a life that glorifies Jesus. That we will seek opportunities to serve others and that our actions will show the world that we are children of God. We pray that the Holy Spirit will give us courage, wisdom, and strength to seek out opportunities to serve others and then to do your will as your Spirit leads us. We pray, Father, that each of us will hear from the Holy Spirit today and that we will receive those words, that they will come into our heart, and that we will respond by doing your will in the world. Father, we all have family members that are sick. We all have family members that need prayer. We all know people that are lonely. We pray for healing in the name and by the blood of Jesus. We pray for peace for family members that are praying for family members that really don't want to be prayed for and don't really want to understand the significance of your presence in their life. We thank you for hearing our prayers today, Father. We know, Father, that we are your hands and feet and that we are to take your message of love out of the church and into the streets and the homes of our town. As we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, we pray that these words will be fresh and new to us today. And not just words that we say every week, because that's what we do every week, but that these words will move us so that as a congregation, we will be able to do your work in our community. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Power, all power, surely is thine.
message today is going to be brought by my new friend, Mary Kendall. I have had the opportunity and privilege to get to know Mary through Bible study and through our prayer meetings. And are you going to tell us something about yourself?
I am.
All right.
Maybe more than you want to know.
To me, no, I won't go into that. All right.
Did you turn? There you go. Father in heaven, I thank you for the privilege of presenting your word today. But Lord, I ask that if you redirect me from what's on my notes, that I would go where you lead me. I pray that everyone that is gathered here and in online would be open to hearing from you this morning. And so I pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. So I realize most of you have no idea who I am, so I thought it might be good for me to tell you a little bit about myself. Well, my name is Mary Kendall. I'm an ordained elder in the Free Methodist Church. I've been married twice, but I stand before you today single. My first marriage ended in divorce, but my second marriage ended with the death of my husband in the year 2000. I have one daughter. Her name is Jessica. She graduated from Penn State with a degree in psychology. She is single. She works for an employment law firm in Cary, North Carolina, right near Raleigh. And she's working her way up to being a paralegal. I have one brother and sister-in-law, Frank and Karen. They live in Hartford, Connecticut. Frank is pastor of a non-denominational church, and he is retiring in June. They have three daughters. They are all married. They have between the three daughters, they now have two granddaughters, and their youngest daughter is currently pregnant with twin boys. So my brother's pretty excited. Though I am a minister, God did not call me into ministry until later in life. It was after my husband's death. I have a degree in Bible/ministry, which means church leadership. I served United Methodist churches for 12 years in Central Florida. And in the early 2000s, I was the children's minister at Aloma United Methodist Church in Winter Park, Florida. Pastor Mike was the youth minister at the time. It was so long ago that if you know Mike and Steph's children, Naomi was crawling around the church nursery at that time, and Caleb was climbing the prayer rail during children's moment. So that's how long ago we met. But I got to know Pastor Mike and Stephanie, and we've remained close friends for many years. While serving United Methodist Churches in Orlando and Winter Haven, I found that I was feeling like a square peg trying to get slammed into a round hole. I just didn't fit. And so a friend of mine who had left the United Methodist Church said, "Why don't you come hang out at the Orlando Fellowship of the Free Methodist Church and see how that feels?" And on my first time there, I knew I was home. And so I began the process of ordination in the Free Methodist Church. Now, this is how you know that I love God and I have lived a called life. After living in Central Florida for 15 years, God called me to return north and serve churches in Central Pennsylvania, Buffalo, New York, and Rochester, New York. In June of 2023, I retired from full-time ministry, and I moved to Mount Dora in September. Now, let me take you back to my childhood in Rochester, New York. So if you're making the connection, God did this big loop with me, and I half the loop, and I hope he doesn't send me back north again. I was raised in a loving Italian family by a very caring mom and dad. We went to church every Sunday morning. Every Sunday afternoon was spent with our extended families. So in the warmer months, we were usually at a local park or a beach, and sometimes at my uncle's pool. In the winter months, we were usually gathered around somebody's table for a large meal. Now, being Italian, we always had lots of food and lots of loud conversation and some yelling. Now, no one was angry with anybody. It was just that Italians tend to yell a lot. And so I got used to that. My mom was a very good and loving mother. She was a hard worker with sound ethics and family values. Through her example, I learned what it meant to be a woman, a wife, and a mother. My mom taught me about religion, but she was unable to teach me about a saving faith in Jesus Christ because she could not teach me something she did not have. Now, that does not in any way take away from the fact that she was a great mom. Even though my brother and I knew all about religion, neither of us came to a saving faith in Jesus Christ until we were in our 30s. Through many conversations with my brother, my dad came to believe that Jesus was the Savior of his life at 87 years of age, just 6 years before his death. And just before her 84th birthday and 7 months before her death, my brother and I were privileged to hear my mother ask Jesus Christ to be the Savior of her life. So if you have been praying for family members for a very long time, don't give up. So that's just a little bit about me and my family history. Now, knowing Mike and Steph for all the years that I did, I would often come to Tavares and vacation with them and stay with them. And as I've been worshiping here at Tavares Community Church for about 7 months, I also want to let you know that I know the challenges that you have faced recently. I know the challenges of the pandemic. I was a pastor during the pandemic. In fact, I got appointed to a church in October of 2020, so I only knew about this much of my congregation for 6 months. I know the challenges you faced, but I also know that you faced the challenges of disaffiliating from the United Methodist Church, and I know the pain that that has caused. And though you never knew it, I was praying for you. As a pastor, I also understand that we have some challenges here at Tavares Community Church. Just looking around the sanctuary on any given Sunday, we can see a few challenges right away. We need some more people. And we need some more age groups. Right? Why? Because a local church is supposed to represent the community in which it's located. As I spend time in Tavares and Eustis and Mount Dora, I see lots of young people, older people, and people of color. I firmly believe that people of all ages, races, and socioeconomic status are important in the life of any effective church. And I do believe that when people walk through the doors of a church for the first time, they want to see people that look like them. I know I do. But please hear me when I tell you that most churches that I have pastored have faced these challenges. Those that struggled and were unable to overcome the challenges did so for the same reasons. Every one of those churches would say that they want to attract more people, and I firmly believe they mean that. But we can't just say that we want more people. We have to act as though we mean it. Most unchurched people, for instance, are not interested in churches that are doing church like the 20th century. If we really want to attract more people, We have to be willing to sit down and talk to them and listen to them. And maybe we're going to have to make some changes. But please hear me on this. We never change or water down the message of Jesus Christ. Now, if I had a church here, somebody would be shouting amen right about now. So let me say that again. We never change or water down the message of Jesus Christ. Amen. We just change how we package it and present it. And honestly, when we start to make some changes, it may feel like a gut punch to some of us. But let me ask you this question. If we made a change or two and helped lost people meet Jesus and move them from death to life, wouldn't that be worth it? We may have some challenges, but I believe we have everything we need. Thankfully, the church is not an industry that runs solely on the world's economy. Wisest church leaders do not focus solely on the world's economy because they know that God's economy does not function like the world's economy. The world's economy functions according to arithmetic, but God's economy functions according to kingdom math, and the two are very different. So let's look at an example of kingdom math in Matthew's gospel. I'll be reading from Matthew chapter 14. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. And I pray that your ears, eyes, and hearts are open to hearing from God this morning through his word. So again, I'm in Matthew chapter 14. I'll begin reading in verse 13. So please listen and receive this word from God. As soon as Jesus heard the news, he had just received the news that his cousin, John the Baptist, was killed. And so as soon as he heard the news, he went off by himself in a boat to a remote area to be alone. But the crowds heard where he was headed and followed by land from many villages. A vast crowd was there as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them, and he healed them. That evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a desolate place, and it is getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to villages and buy food for themselves." But Jesus replied, "That isn't necessary. You feed them." "Impossible," they exclaimed. "We have only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. "Bring them here," he said. And then he told the people to sit down on the grass, and he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looked up toward heaven, and asked God's blessing on the food. And breaking the loaves into pieces, he gave some of the bread and fish to each disciple. And the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate as much as they wanted, and they picked up 12 baskets of leftovers. About 5,000 men had eaten from those 5 loaves, in addition to all the women and children. Now, many of Jesus' disciples were fishermen. Matthew, our gospel writer, was a tax collector. So they understood arithmetic. The fishermen owned their own businesses. They understood 1 + 1 = 2. And Matthew really understood arithmetic. On this day, though, the disciples saw that there was a problem. They knew that 5 loaves and 2 fish would not feed 5,000 men. And so they tossed the problem to Jesus and said, "You've got to fix this." And Jesus tossed it back to them and said, "No, you fix it." And they quickly started making excuses for why they couldn't possibly fix this problem. There was not enough food. There were too many people. Simple arithmetic said this was not a problem they were going to figure out. The numbers just don't work. But Jesus does not use arithmetic to solve problems. Jesus uses kingdom math. And in verses 17 and 18, they said to him, "We have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." And so they brought him what they had. And Jesus turned to his Father in heaven and prayed. And he relied on the Holy Spirit to solve the problem. And that is when the miracle happened. Everyone had their fill, and there were 12 baskets of leftovers. That's not arithmetic. That's kingdom math. But as I was studying Matthew's gospel in this part, I noticed something very interesting. In the very next chapter, Matthew records a very similar occurrence. Once again, Jesus had been out healing people. But this time, they'd been there for 3 days. So let's look at that passage in chapter 15. I'll begin reading in verse 32. Then Jesus called his disciples to him and said, "I feel sorry for these people. They have been here with me for 3 days, and they have nothing left to eat. I don't want to send them away hungry, or they will faint along the way." The disciples replied, "And where would we get enough food out here in the wilderness to feed all these people?" Jesus asked, "How many loaves of bread do you have?" And they replied, 7, and a few small fish. So Jesus told all the people to sit down on the ground, and then he took the 7 loaves and the fish, thanked God for them, broke them into pieces, and gave them to the disciples, who distributed the food to the crowd. They all ate until they were full, and when the scraps were picked up, there were 7 large baskets of food left over. There were 4,000 men who were fed that day, in addition to all the women and children. Now, Matthew must have had hundreds of memories that he could have recorded in his gospel, but he chose this one. Why tell nearly the same thing so close together? Now, there's some differences. One had 5,000 men, one had 4,000. One had 5 loaves and 2 fish. The other had 7 loaves and a few fish. One had 12 baskets of leftover, the other 7. Why would he tell such a similar story so quickly? I think it's easy for us to read through these lessons and focus on the miracles and miss a deeper truth. You see, the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were never meant to just be a collection of interesting stories about Jesus. The Holy Spirit inspired these writers to record the events that would help the church, and that means you, and that means me, to do what Jesus commissioned us to do: make disciples. These 4 Gospels make up a discipleship manual, kind of a DIY manual for how to make disciples. These 4 Gospels were never meant to just be memorized and taught. They were meant to be understood and followed. Bible teacher Dan Wilt says it this way: studying the Bible plays a huge part in us becoming discipled witnesses of what Jesus can do in and through us. But if Bible study is the extent of our discipleship, then the written word of God left unapplied remains unbelieved. In other words, Jesus is not interested in simply educating and informing us. Jesus is not interested in giving us lectures, reviewing the material, and then serving up a test on what we have come to know about Christ. His goal is that we would become his apprentices, his witnesses, those who live like he lives, love like he loves, and do what he does in our homes and in our neighborhoods. I think one thing is clear as we read through the Gospels. Jesus loves people. He loves people. In the first passage, Jesus had gotten into a boat to withdraw from the crowd so that he could grieve the death of his cousin, John the Baptist. But when he got to shore, there was a great crowd of people waiting for him there. Matthew tells us that when Jesus saw the crowd, he felt compassion for them, and he healed them. When the disciples told him the people were hungry but did not have any food, Jesus did all he could to feed them. Why? Because Jesus loves people. In the second passage I read, we see Jesus loving people once again. After 3 days of healing people, Matthew tells us that Jesus felt compassion for all these people that had been with him there for 3 days, waiting for healing. Jesus said, "They have nothing to eat, and I do not want to send them away hungry." Now, I'm sure after 3 days of healing people, Jesus himself was tired and hungry. But his concern was for the people. And so he fed them. Why? Because Jesus loves people. But I do not think that Matthew simply wants us to know and have head knowledge that Jesus loves people. If these words are part of a discipleship manual, we are supposed to love people. Not just the ones we like. Not just the ones that treat us well. Not just the ones that look like us or act like us or talk like us or dress like us. We are supposed to love all people because Jesus loved all people. Why is it then that we humans who call ourselves followers of Jesus tend to pick and choose the people we're going to love? I think it's because we forget the outcome of the miracles. You see, the outcome of the miracles was not that just people were fed and satisfied, but there were leftovers, lots of leftovers. Jesus did not just meet the need of the people. Jesus gave them more than enough. And that is what his love does. And we tend to forget that. Instead of realizing the enormity of his love, we live with this scarcity mentality. And I'm sad to say that churches do it all the time. We tend to do arithmetic like the disciples did. The numbers don't add up. Did my mic just go out? The numbers don't add up. Thank you. And so we wring our hands. And we start worrying, oh no, what are we going to do? But what happens in a church is we tend to hold very tightly to whatever money we do have. We tend to rely solely on arithmetic, and we forget all about kingdom math. But if you were listening closely, kingdom math works in the same way every time. We have to bring Jesus what we have. And we have to lay it at his feet and then turn to the Father in prayer. That's what our nights of prayer are all about here. We need to bring what we have to Jesus and pray to our Father. And then rely on the Holy Spirit and believe that he can fix our problems. I don't know how much time had elapsed between the feeding of the 5,000 and the feeding of the 4,000. But no matter how much time had elapsed, could it be that the disciples forgot about feeding 5,000 people? It seems like they did. When Jesus suggested feeding the 4,000, Matthew recorded the response. Now keep in mind, Matthew was probably one of the disciples that had that response. They said, where would we get enough bread to feed all these people? That's scarcity mentality. The numbers don't add up. And in churches, I've heard too many times, we can't support missionaries. We have to keep money in our savings account. What more does Jesus have to do to teach us that when we live in his love and extend that love to others, there's always enough, more than enough. So here's my challenge for each of us here. Think back over all the ways Jesus has met the needs of this church in the past when it seemed like there just wasn't enough. And then stand on those memories and stand on the written word of God. Because with Jesus and his love, we will always have more than enough. And so that's my challenge to each of us. I'm going to ask you to think of the ways Jesus has met your needs in the church. But what about in your own life? I know over all my years, there have been days that the arithmetic didn't add up. There was more money going out than coming in. But somehow, the bills got paid. And I'm sure that's happened to you once or twice in your life as well. Write some of these down and post them somewhere so you will remember them. And remember this. Jesus does not expect Pastor Mike or any of us to grow this church. Because this church doesn't belong to you or me or Pastor Mike. This church belongs to Jesus, and he said, I will grow my church. And so remember that Jesus is our provider, and he will always give us what we need and more than enough. We just have to bring him what we have, pray to the Father, and rely and believe that the Holy Spirit will give us what we need. So let's remember these things this morning as we prepare our hearts and our minds to receive the elements in Holy Communion. And I'm going to invite you to pray with me. So let's pray. We do not come to this your table, merciful Lord, with self-confidence and pride, trusting in our own righteousness, but we trust in your great and many mercies. We are not worthy to gather the crumbs from under your table. But you, O Lord, are unchanging in your mercy, and your nature is love. Grant us, therefore, God of mercy, God of grace, to eat at this your table so that we may receive in spirit and in truth the body of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and the merits of his shed blood, so that we may live and grow in his likeness, and being washed and cleansed through his most precious blood, we may evermore live in him and he in us. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I always found it interesting that on the last night of his earthly life, Jesus didn't go home. He gathered his friends together for that last meal. And as he gathered his friends together, he took bread. And he blessed it. And he broke it. And he passed it to his friends and he said, take this and eat. And every time you do this, remember me. And then when the supper was ended, he took a cup, and again, he blessed it. And he passed it to his friends, and he said, take and drink. And every time you do this, remember me. Remember what you've seen me do. Remember the words I've spoken to you. Remember the miracles. Remember me. And so I'm going to invite the stewards that are serving communion to come at this time. We do have gluten-free elements if you need them. But I also want to ask you that as you receive the elements, remember Jesus. Don't just say, okay, I remember Jesus. Think about what you've seen. Think about how he's interacted with you in life. Remember him. And so, which one of you wants the bread? And the juice. So as you are ready, you may come up the center aisle and then return by the outer aisles, but come and remember Jesus. Does anyone need the elements brought to them? Okay. This is the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, broken and shed for you.
Our final hymn today is Amazing Grace. If you will stand and sing with us, please.
Thank you, Jesus. As you leave this place today, I'm going to ask you, as you go about your week, consider wherever you find yourself that God has sent you there. And that maybe someone around you just needs a smile or a hug from Him. And maybe you're the one that He sent to that particular place on that particular day to bring His love to others. So let's go out and be His hands and His feet this week. Amen? Amen. Amen. Have a wonderful week.